Welcome to All Things Financial with Jack Driscoll. Each week, Jack takes on all things you thought were hard to understand about your finances and makes it fun, easy, but most of all, interesting. From insurance to the best way to save your money and squeeze the most out of the dollars you put aside for your rainy day. And now, you have a friend in the money business. Here's your host, Jack Driscoll.
Welcome back to another edition of All Things Financial. I'm Jack Driscoll, and I'm here with a guest today. We're privileged to have Colin Morgan from Julian Gray Associates. Colin, thanks so much for coming in.
Thank you so much for having me.
Colin came in today to talk about some areas that happen unexpectedly. It's not something we necessarily can plan for. And I'll let Colin explain, but it's something I wanted to bring Colin on the show and just go through some scenarios on what we need to be aware of before they happen.
Personal injury post-settlement planning has become an enormous part of my practice over the last, I'd say, 3 or 4 years.
Okay.
It's the exact same skill set as an elder care attorney, but it's dealing with an individual who has experienced a catastrophic injury.
Okay.
They're not going back to work.
Okay.
And they're getting a large settlement, and this is, you know, their one shot at making this last through the rest of their life expectancy.
Yeah.
And it's a vital, vital time in individuals' lives. You hear the horror stories.
Mm-hmm.
The person gets a $200,000 check, and 2 weeks later you see an $80,000 truck parked in the driveway.
Cool.
And you go, that's not a good estate plan. Initially I was brought in to do kind of the easy stuff. Opening estates for decedents and doing basic, you know, documents, wills, and powers of attorney for individuals.
Okay.
But as it started emerging, and as we were seeing individuals in need of skilled nursing at the home,
mm-hmm.
Long-term care style benefits, our skill set really came into play. We were working toward helping protect these resources from factors like the federal government, from mm-hmm. taxes, from the clients themselves at some point. So we were employing techniques that we've, you know, honed over the years for our, you know, elder care clients, and employing them in circumstances, you know, where we're working with younger people who may have been, you know, victims of construction accidents or building collapses,
mm-hmm.
or, you know, catastrophic car accidents, things like that.
Okay.
And they're in need of those services, very financially vulnerable. You know, a 30-year-old construction worker who was just, you know, grievously injured.
Right.
Okay, they're just starting out.
Mm-hmm.
You know, this is a person, they might have a couple kids, they might be married, but they're behind the game about 30 or 40 years before
okay.
they were originally going to retire.
Mm-hmm.
And now they're getting this large settlement. We need to make sure that they're being helped. And so, mm-hmm. you know, it's a very fragile situation to work with.
So you see what I hear a lot then about people that when they are unprepared on managing money, that they have not developed the skills over a long
sure.
period of time, and then a large amount of money gets thrust on them, like lottery winners.
Oh, yeah.
We've all heard the stories of some lottery winnings are squandered, and the people that received them are worse off than they were before they ever won the proceeds. Is that similar what you're seeing
oh,
sometimes
yeah.
in this case here?
Absolutely. And it's the worst kind of lottery to win. Every single personal injury client would pay whatever their settlement was times 10 to be made whole again.
Wow.
Unfortunately, you know, the best we can come up with as attorneys to make somebody whole is, you know, through financial means. You
right.
know, we sue whoever committed the negligent act, and
mm-hmm.
we try to get as much as we can to provide for that person and their family. But it's a minefield for the client.
Mm-hmm.
And like I said, you're working with younger folks, people who, geez, they didn't even ever talk to a financial planner or an
right.
estate planning
right.
attorney prior to this. And this is something that nobody can plan for. You know, nobody plans to get catastrophically injured. I sure hope they don't.
Right.
That's,
right.
you know, maybe, you know, a stuntman or something
yeah.
like that. But, you know, these are circumstances that are emotional. They carry a lot of surprise and shock.
Yeah.
And they're extremely difficult. Unfortunately, a lot of my clients going through personal injury matters are subsequently going through other issues out there. They're getting divorced.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes there are, you know, drug issues that occur afterward. Mental health problems. You know, this is a, it's not just the physical injury.
I see.
And so the services that we've learned to provide for these clients are, they're just as much social work as they are estate planning.
The injury or whatever prompted this might impact mental acuity too. So they might not be able to make as good decisions as they would have before, right?
Absolutely.
And so then it falls on what? Trusted loved ones or someone sometimes?
Yeah.
So that you can plan for in advance, saying, if something happens to me, here's who I trust to help manage through that, right?
Absolutely.
Even though they're newbies too. So they might not have had anything to do with finances in their own lives or yours either. Might be a spouse or someone else, parent, but whoever it is. At least that part could be planned for in advance, right?
Absolutely, or executed quickly. So I say that oftentimes if you come to our firm as a traditional estate planning or elder care client, we're going to give you a questionnaire. You're going to get us the questionnaire back. We'll do a consultation. We'll meet with you for a couple hours, design a plan, send a proposal, send drafts. When I get a personal injury client, especially a catastrophically injured client, I get in the car, I drive to the client, I sign them up, and I get wills and powers done as soon as humanly possible.
Oh, I see.
Because, you know, medically fragile individuals can have a whole host of ensuing issues as time goes on.
Okay, that so I would not have thought about.
Yeah, and so it's a different approach, you know.
Yeah, I wouldn't have thought about that.
Yeah, and it's, and I've learned that from my colleagues in personal injury, where they don't wait, you know, to start advocating for their client. They get right on it. And it's been a great lesson for me, and it's been also, you know, learning all of the other stuff that occurs around, you know, catastrophic injuries. Like, I've sat through 10-hour divorce mediations to, you know, be there to represent my client, but also to, you know, be there with the client. This is a tough situation. Estate planning is a very positive thing. Personal injury settlement planning is, this horrible thing happened to me. And I get one shot at protecting these resources for the rest of my life. How do I make sure, you know, that that doesn't get messed up? And to your point, when you said trusted loved ones, sadly, in many cases, it's not the trusted loved ones who are the first people to get a hold of these clients. A lot of people will see money coming from a personal injury settlement, and all of a sudden, the cousins they haven't heard from for years start, you know, coming. The friend who wants to open the pizza shop, you know, calls for a loan. It seems like a great opportunity.
Really?
We'll get it back to you times two. You know, all that stuff happens. And it's the same thing as with the lottery winners. Our firms actually represented a number of lottery winners as well.
Okay.
And what it is, a good way of describing it, is sudden wealth management.
Yeah.
All of a sudden, I'm a 24-year-old guy who's, you know, working and saving up, and all of a sudden I can't work anymore, but I'm getting $1 million in the personal injury settlement.
Right, right.
That is a dangerous situation to be in, and a lot of people don't even realize it.
Okay. So they get one shot at doing this right, and it's their first time of ever doing it in life.
Exactly.
Now, many of us, we know we've invested into our 401ks over a period of time, and then we stumble, fall, the markets fall, and, you know, some money gets lost, and we pick ourselves back up and we say, okay, next time we'll do that better, or we'll get this right.
Right.
But these people, that's not the scenario at all that we're dealing with here.
No.
It's
no.
all now, all at once, the most you've ever seen and ever dreamt you'd see in your life, and it has to last you for the rest of your life, including all the unforeseen events that are yet to come that we can't even be aware of.
Exactly. And add this on top of it. It's an expensive thing being a catastrophically injured person. We're looking at, you know, modifying or purchasing a new home. We're modifying every vehicle we buy for the person if the person is capable enough to drive.
Nice.
You know, we need to look at long-term care for people who might be on long-term care for 40 plus years. You know, this isn't, the average nursing home stay for an elderly person is around 3 years.
Okay.
The average, you know, lifespan I'm seeing, we get what's called a life care plan.
Okay.
For a personal injury recipient, this is medical professionals' best guess as to what this person's medical picture is going to look like. And so we're looking at life expectancies of 30 plus years, 40 plus years. And so if they're paying, and here's what's interesting, you know, you hear the stories and you talk to people about their perceptions of personal injury and they go, oh, look, this person got hurt and they're getting $5 million. That's a heck of a lot of money.
Yeah.
Well, if you're spending $300,000 per year in medical care, $5 million isn't a lot of money.
Do you see that?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. In-home care.
That's scary.
Oh, it is. And you have to plan for it. And so, and you have to plan for government benefits for it. It might seem odd to you, but I have people who have seven figures in trust planning to get onto medical assistance.
Wow.
Imagine that. So, you know, it's basically, it's taking the entirety of elder law and estate planning, compressing it over a 2 to 6 year period, which is the, you know, basic duration of a personal injury suit. So my advice to clients and practitioners in the field is the moment that client gets signed up is when we should get involved.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, we take on these cases just like the personal injury attorneys. In other words, we're not charging people a fee.
Okay.
We're contingent. If they get a settlement, we'll talk about, compensation and things like
right,
that.
Right, I see.
But our goal,
the proceeds.
Exactly. Most of the people that I meet in personal injury matters are on the ropes financially.
Okay.
They're paying significant money for medical care on top of everything else, and they've just lost an income. You know, if it's a family.
Or maybe two.
Yeah,
because
exactly.
The spouse might have to quit work.
Exactly. And so our goal is to not, you know, we want to help people. Yeah. We're not coming into that situation and, you know, looking for, you know, a fee or anything like that. So we'll help a client through the entire process. I don't care if it takes 6 months or 6 years. We're going to hang on with them the whole time.
So you're saying then I might have someone who makes $50,000 a year, and then when we get a lump sum settlement, we're assuming as financial planners, let's build this to be able to provide $50,000 a year for the rest of their lives. But that doesn't account for potential inflation,
right,
which will inevitably occur. Probably doesn't account for taxes, which might grow that number to $70,000 or $75,000 a year, who knows. And it's got to last sometimes 30 or 40 years, so it has to increase for inflation. So we can't just go in and use up principal. And then you're adding on top of that, the majority of their needs annually might have nothing to do with income.
Yeah.
It might be medical expenses like $200,000 or $300,000 on top of that. Yearly?
I've had multiple clients receiving 24-hour care, nursing care. Again, you're looking at, you know, quadriplegic individuals or, you know, people who just need significant assistance. And that's a $30,000 to $40,000 per month expense.
Yikes.
It's
how do they
unbelievable.
Do it? I don't see how they could do it. I don't see how the assets that they receive in a judgment could possibly be adequate enough to handle that.
And that's why we do planning. Planning, you know, for benefits like medical assistance, Medicare covers a lot of those costs. And that's a great point. And you know, if you look at the ledger line, the settlement might look like a lot of money. This is a great nest egg.
Yeah.
And then you look at the delta on the other side, which is the medical expenses, you go, God, I got 10 years.
Yeah.
There isn't a product in the world that's going to run that kind of income.
Right.
And you know, there isn't a plan in the world that can make that work. Aside from if you can expedite an individual getting onto a program like medical assistance or Medicare, that's going to, you know, the blend of those two programs can cover the vast amount of, you know, that need, you're preserving the principle of that settlement for quality of life. So this is, you know, what medical assistance doesn't provide for is, how am I going to buy clothes?
Okay.
They're going to take all my income, you know, if I don't save some of the, you know, principle of these resources.
Right.
So what about putting my kids through college? Mm-hmm. You know, things like that. We have planning techniques where, you know, I've set up plans to expedite a person onto medical assistance, but I've still socked away enough money to make sure that they're, you know, that the client's children, they can go to college if they want to. They can get their braces, they can get their sports equipment, their first car, their down payment on their house, get married, those types of things.
Yeah.
And I think that that's extremely important. Why are we even going through all the trouble of the personal injury settlement if we're just going to churn it right back into a nursing home or to the Commonwealth.
Yeah,
or something
and five
like
or
that.
10 years later, it'd yeah. all be gone.
Why do we? The only people who are making money are the lawyers. Yeah. You know, if we do it yeah. that way. And so, you know, and I've been extremely fortunate to work with Pittsburgh's judiciary, you know, in or you know, our lawyers in personal injury are very forward thinking with mm-hmm. the with these items. You know, I love people who think Pittsburgh's a small town, you know, where I go, well, you know, we're pretty cutting edge with this stuff. But these are guys who come to us and say, we need to, you know, they care about their clients. Mm-hmm. it bucks the trend of what people think, you know, a personal injury law practice is. These are people who get into this because they care about their clients, they're fighting for their clients, and they would never want to see the fruits of that fight just evaporate and go away.
So to really do a good job, you kind of have to think, not what can I get for you, but how can I provide you the highest quality of life for the rest of your
sure.
years, which is contingent somewhat on the money, too.
Absolutely.
You know, being not only awarded, but also properly implemented, and also all the other tools you're saying that aren't financial tools,
yeah,
they all work together.
Takes a village. It really does.
Yeah. Okay.
Having a good estate planning attorney, elder care planning attorney, a good accountant, and a good financial, you know, planner mm-hmm. at the table is what's necessary to help these clients.
Do you see a difference when someone's married versus someone not being married? Is the planning different or is it similar?
Well, it's similar in as much as, you know, if the expenses are so high, mm-hmm. you know, there's less that we can protect, even through medical assistance, we can protect, you know, a large portion of, you know, an estate via okay. a spouse, but that only goes up to about $127,000 right now. So that's good, and we can work with that. But yeah, with a married couple, we also have another person to, you know, to provide for.
And I was wondering about that.
Yeah. And to your point, and that was a very good point, it's very frequently where we see a spouse leaving his or her job to be a full-time caregiver. Mm-hmm. And that's also a person that we need to protect. But they're also, you know, with all due respect to our professions, they're not, social workers aren't like us, right? You know, lawyers are blunt instruments,
yeah.
you know? you know, we're not the, you don't call your lawyer when you need a shoulder to cry on. so our social workers, they're warm people. They integrate with the family. Mm-hmm. You know, oftentimes they're the first call, you know, from the client at this point. And, you know, to segue a little bit, it's altered how I approach clients. From a personal injury perspective, I'm working with people who are going through a lot. Again, you know, the mental health issues and the family issues and addiction issues and all that kind of stuff yeah. crops up. People get catastrophically injured. They're medicated for a while, mm-hmm. and then they get the rug pulled out from under them, and they
right.
don't know where to go.
Unexpectedly.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And they don't know how to manage their care.
Okay.
And so getting professionals involved, you know, getting the right doctors involved, having those resources, yeah. you know, at, you know, less than arm's length, you know, is a good way of protecting yeah. your clients. So you really have to, as a personal injury settlement planning attorney, I'm kind of playing defense for my client.
Yeah.
You know, I'm pushing away the high school buddy who wants to open the bar, or, you know, the family member who thinks they know how
yeah,
medical
oh,
care
yeah.
should be managed,
yeah.
or
like with
you
an
know,
athlete
yeah.
who only has four years of major income
exactly
earning potential, and then it closes
sure.
again. Everybody comes out of the woodwork on that.
And the analogy is a lot tighter than you think with a personal injury settlement client, because those athletes are going to need a lot of medical care too. So you should be planning for the same kind of stuff. So, you know, you understand the circumstances are extremely hard mm-hmm. in personal injury cases. And these are some of the saddest cases that I've worked on. There are times when you just sit in your car and you just need a moment, you know, after the consult, you know, when you're talking. And then you have to say, all right, now we got to protect them, you know?
You know, on the planning side of things, when I think of planning, and I opened the show with, you really can't plan for this and you really can't foresee it. But in reality, there are things that you can understand. And I think one of them is, of the thousands of people viewing and listening to this show, at least one of you, this will happen to. We just don't know which one. It might be me. Yeah. We don't know which one, but we do know it is one. So what we do in the financial planning side is we say, prepare for the unexpected, plan for the unexpected. And what that involves in many cases is, okay, what kind of accidents could happen? Workers' compensation, I'm at work. Car accidents, I'm in a car. So you, or just a heart attack. So you look at those and say, okay, when you do financial planning and you do estate planning, what if one of those things happened to me? What could I do in advance to better prepare for it? What should I do in advance? And the first things I can think of are, number one, look at your insurances. If you work for someone, are you getting a 1099 or are you an employee? Are you on a workers' compensation plan or are you not? If you're a 1099 employee, you're not. So do you have disability insurance? Are you being responsible for the things that you and your family are contingent on, which is your ability to continue receiving income? So we're looking at disability insurance. If you don't have it, you need it. We've always said in the industry, if you owned a goose that laid golden eggs, which would you insure first, the goose or the eggs? Well, most people are insuring their homes and their cars and not insuring the goose that's the income earning vehicle and animal that actually produces everything, and that's you. So number one, we're looking at that. Number two, make sure you're on workers' compensation insurance and not working under the table. Number three, on your own car insurance, and this is the big one. Do you have coverages if you're hurt in a car accident? Do you have full tort or limited tort? Do you even know what that means? Because if you don't, you might be precluding your own self from the very benefits Colin is explaining if you happen to have one and not the other. Can you get into that for a little bit for people? Because that is something people can prepare in advance.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, and workers' compensation is a big deal. You're hitting on a lot of great points. And one of the best adages I ever heard from one of my clients, I work with a lot of, you know, grandfathers and grandmothers, and people are just these fonts of wisdom, right? Okay. You know, I learn probably way more from my clients than they learn from me. And one of my favorite ones was, well, you plan for the worst and you hope for the best.
Okay.
And a lot of it is building relationships with the professionals who are going to jump in an unforeseen set of circumstances. Mm-hmm. So if I am a person who becomes catastrophically injured, if I have an estate planning attorney, if I have a financial planner, if I have an accountant, those people are going to deploy, circle the wagons around me and start helping.
Right.
And so while, you know, people think, well, it's not like I can call Robert Pearson Associates today and say, you know, if I ever get hurt, you should help me out.
Right.
You know, you can't do that, but what you can do is get all the people who are going to get you in the right direction. Mm-hmm. But to your point, you know, car insurance, all of those are so important. And, you know, especially, and it's a great point that you have when you talk about, you know, not working under the table. Mm-hmm. It's tough. Nobody likes to pay taxes.
Right.
But, you know, oftentimes paying those taxes are what protect you from when you're most vulnerable, you know, given these types of circumstances. Mm-hmm. And what we're seeing a lot is, you know, or another set of services that you need to consider is in workers' comp cases. Mm-hmm. Workers' comp covers so much for you if you become catastrophically injured, if mm-hmm. it's a workplace injury. But they come knocking at the end of the personal injury matter, and they want paid back to a certain modicum.
Ah.
So having a professional who's going to step in and say, okay, we'll pay you back, but we're not paying everything.
Okay.
You know, they accept it. They accept one thing automatically, mm-hmm. okay, which is better than nothing.
Okay.
But then with a little bit more effort, they'll beat that number down even farther.
Yeah.
So there's advocacy in every step of this type of process. Mm-hmm. So where it starts is building that relationship, having that, you know, great financial planner, having, you know, that estate planning elder care attorney, having that accountant who, if, you know, if my spouse calls one of these people and says, Colin just got in a car accident, you know, they're saying that he's, you know, going to need a lot of medical care moving mm-hmm. forward. They can say, okay, we're going to start working, you right. know, on this. So, you know, it's harder to start cold and all these things and start yeah. you know, okay, well, let's interview three attorneys and let's interview three financial planners and see, you know, if you already have that relationship with a qualified professional, they're going to jump right in and start helping.
The other thing, Colin, is if anybody's ever been subject to being hurt at work or a car accident, our general advice in our office has always been, you're dealing with insurance companies who have interests that may or may not be in alignment with yours. So our advice has always been in our office, initially, at the time of the injury, or as close after that as you can, before you're dealing with the insurance companies, our advice has always been, consult with an attorney who specializes in these issues to help get someone on your
Absolutely.
Side to guide you, not to sue, but to guide you to make sure you're not making mistakes, not signing wrong forms inadvertently or prematurely, and just simply protecting your rights that you're entitled to, because you won't know you're making mistakes along the way, but the insurance company will. So that's been our advice in our office in all
advice.
Of these years, where most people are involved in an accident at work and say, it'll be fine, or they're involved in a car accident, I'm really not hurt, and we'll say, before you give statements and before you sign forms and before you accept checks, get to an attorney just to review the situation, get someone on your team to help guide you through to make sure your rights are protected yeah. through the whole thing. Is that right?
Oh, absolutely. And it sounds almost cliche to say this, but every attorney you ever talk to is going to say, don't talk to anybody until you talk to me.
Yeah.
You know?
Because people wait too long
right.
until it's too late and then say, I think I need an attorney. And sometimes they've gone down the road a little bit too far to
sure.
get all they're entitled to or protect all their rights.
Exactly. And I see that type of advocacy comes along the way multiple times during representation. And I think I'll get a reaction from you out of this. You know, when you're approaching settlement in a case, which mm-hmm. 90% of all personal injury cases settle, over mm-hmm. 90%.
Okay.
When you're in that final mediation and we're finally figuring out what the number is, all of a sudden somebody's going to get off a plane in a really expensive suit and walk into the room and offer the plaintiff a structured settlement. And you go, who is this guy?
Yeah.
You know, and this is a representative of the insurance company mm-hmm. Who's normally selling products by that insurance company, mm-hmm. designed by that insurance company, as hired by the defendant.
Okay.
And so from an advocacy perspective, you got to bring your own professional, financial professional in. Mm-hmm. And that's not us. That's a financial planner. That's
yeah.
somebody who's going to say, well, wait, we don't want the structure in this case because we can do other things.
Right.
Because as a defendant, what would I rather do? Give equal monthly payments over 20 years mm-hmm. based on the settlement amount, or give the entire thing up front?
Okay.
Let me give myself an interest-free
seems
loan.
Seems common sense,
yeah.
but...
Yeah. But at the time, it's emotional. It's been years. We're waiting for this. You know, maybe we're having mortgage issues or all of this stuff is happening, all this outside noise, and people are very vulnerable and very weak at that point. We'll just say, okay, you know, I'll just sign on
yeah.
it.
Yeah.
And so you don't go with what the defense's attorney says. So you should definitely not go with what
at
the
least
defense's
level
financial
the,
guy
level
says.
Level the playing field and have your
exactly.
team as well equipped serving
right.
you.
Okay. Right. So to your point, advocacy happens the entire process on numerous different fronts. You need an entire team of professionals to navigate one of these cases successfully.
Well, Colin, thanks so much for coming in and shedding light on this area that
Thank you.
Is not often talked about, but it is something that we're able to plan for. Colin, appreciate it very much.
Likewise,
and
thank you.
And thanks everyone for tuning in to another edition of All Things Financial. We'll be back again next week.